Sailing. Thank you. shit.
Thank you.
Amen.
I have the wrong, no more.
spirit, send him to die. I scarce can take it in. Because God is alive. Amen. He is still alive. Hallelujah. Yes, we are mourning the loss of our brother, but we have a blessed assurance that our brother made his calling and election sure. Amen. We're not here to be quiet, you know. See, this quieting don't work sometimes. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land. Amen. Hallelujah. Hear my cry, O Lord. Attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. Oh, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. The rock is higher than I. been a shelter for me. And a strong tower from the enemy. Oh, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. The rock is higher than I. Oh, that is higher than I. That is higher than I. Oh, if you want to see the glory of the Lord, why don't you praise Him? Lift up your hands and praise Him. If you want to see the glory of the Lord, why don't you lift up your hands and praise the Lord? Oh, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime. Oh, praise Him all the day long, lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Oh, if you want to see the glory of the Lord, why don't you praise Him? Up your hands and praise the Lord. Oh, praise Him in the, praise Him in the, praise Him in the. Oh, praise Him all the day long. Lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Oh, lift up your hands, lift up your hands, lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Praise Him, I know. The blessings will flow. Lift up your hands. Oh, lift up your hands. Lift up your hands. Lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Praise Him, I know, and the blessings will flow. Lift up your hands and Lord. And if you want to see the glory of the Lord, why don't you praise Him? Up your hands and praise the Lord. Oh, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime, praise Him in the evening. Oh, praise Him all the day long. Oh, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the evening. Oh, praise Him all the day long. Lift up your hands and
say no. Nobody can say no. When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. When Jesus says yes, nobody can say no.
If there is anybody here who haven't experienced Jesus, I summons you to try him today, because he never fails. He is always available. Hallelujah. Any circumstances you have, our Jesus can handle it. Don't leave this place just as you came. Give your heart to Christ, because he is coming again. Hallelujah. The anchor hold, though the ship is battered. The anchor hold, though the sails are torn.
Keeps our souls steadfast while the billows roll, yes? And that is why we can rejoice this evening in spite of the circumstances. At this time, we are going to have a Bible reading from our dear brother Ellis Clark.
Church. But as I have the mic, I don't want to come against, I'll do my bit now and finish. Now, Eugene was a very dear cousin of mine. At that time, I describe it as an uncommon feat. Eugene always said, boy, Ellis, when I try to walk again, boy, you're going to be troubling him. I said, this man have a fractured hip, fractured hand, you know, and he had the faith that he was going to walk still. That's the kind of faith that Eugene had. And I said, and you know, I thought to myself one day, I said, he had so much thing going on in his life, you know, doing dialysis and everything, and he still had the faith that he could walk again. And it behooves all of us to also have that faith that Eugene. Eugene was more like a brother to me. Many a times we go places and people ask, Eugene, what man look like you? So, boy, damn it, brother. No man look more like your father than he, which was true. If you knew my father, Eugene looks more like my father than me. And he always said, people, that man, the one Clark, is my daddy. Damn it, brother. And my wife, both of my wife, my wife was his sister. And he treated her just like his sister. When my wife was saved, he was moving from my wife every day. I want to talk to you now. Let me talk to my sister. And I saw the project that he had. I mean, I'll miss him dearly, but God knows best. And you know, many a times we might not understand, but God knows best. All right? Our scripture reading this afternoon is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50 and 58. I'm reading from the King James Version. And it says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Brother Ellis. Keeping it moving, we have another scripture reading by Sister Samantha. And I think Sister Samantha. Sister Samantha, I didn't make you out in the crowd at all.
Hallelujah. Good evening, church. Today's scripture reading is taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 11. To everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to gain and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. What profit has the worker from that in which he labors? I have seen the God-given task with which the sons of men are to be occupied. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts, except that no one can find out the work that God has done, the work that God does from beginning to end. This is the word of God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Sister Samantha. So at this time, we've come to the point where we're going to take tributes. And like I said before, we have to keep it short and tight. First on the list, we have some people from the T and Tech institution who is going to come to bring tributes. Next in line will be the dialysis unit from Scarborough, so you could get yourself ready, please.
Davidson, Eugene Bruce, who are a good friend of mine. I have known him for quite a long while because we work under contractors together, driving truck. Then TM Tech, we ended up and we had that same community from that time. I want to say that Eugene was a very dedicated person, dedicated to his work. Wherever he goes to work, he always showed that interest in wherever he worked. And I just want to say that to that his soul, rest in peace, and to the family from Tiantec and present workers in Tiantec and also pensioners, wish you all condolences and to stay strong, continue to trust Almighty God.
Thank you so very much. Moving right along, the dialysis unit. The dialysis unit of the Scarborough Health Center, please. Anybody coming? Okay, so like those people not here yet. So we're going to call Miss Anita Kennedy to come and pay her tribute. Miss Kennedy. Put your hands together as Miss Kennedy comes to render her tribute for us this evening.
Good evening, everyone. I want to sing this song especially for Eugene and his family. Life is easy when you're up on the mountain. You've got peace like you never know. How things change when you're down in the valley.
wife of Brother Eugene. And although this is about Brother Eugene's death this evening, I just want to say that Hilda has been a really faithful wife to her husband. And she may never hear that said to her again after today, because nobody tell you these things. Hilda has labored in love until the day that Eugene has passed away. I never heard Hilda complain. She may talk sometimes, but never complain. And I really want to compliment her that you're going to keep complaining. I don't want to describe your case. But I think that's what God is going to do. God is going to do. And God understands your cry of prayer. And you're going to grieve, but you know that God is going to comfort you through His love and through His voice. And the rest of the family, may God continue to comfort you in this your time of grief.
This time we are going to call our beloved Apostle, Pastor Reverend Nelson, to come and bring tribute on behalf of the abundant life with reference to our
Madam Chairperson this evening. Hearty welcome to those of you that are here in person, and then of course those of you that are joining us, amen, virtually online. I'm here to just bring a few words on behalf of the Abundant Life Mission Church, of which the deceased Eugene Bruce was part of the membership. And not only part of the membership, but I believe he would have made his contributions in so many different ways. Eugene, as far as I know him, and as far as I was told, there is some kind of family connection. Is that so, Wayne? All right. So we are related in some way. The little that I've known of Eugene over the years is that he was a lover of a number of things. Number one, he loved his vehicle. Not love to the extent where it became a god. But I believe as a man who worked very hard in his life, he knew the value and the importance of taking care of what he had. And he used to do his endeavor best to keep that car up and running. He was also a lover of music. I tell you, I guess maybe sometimes he had us to ask him to turn on our music. Because he loved his music. He would have spent whatever monies that he believed he could put into something that he loved. So he loved life, and there were certain things that were dear to him. In respect to his membership of the Abundant Life Mission Church, which I was privileged to look at him for a little while, because to God be the glory, I was the one who basically initiated or actually planted the ministry here in Signal Hill. Formerly we met close to the Piccadilly corner there. And Eugene accompanied his wife whenever possible can at the ministry. And not forgetting the fact that he was also a member of the People's Pentecostal Church as well. And we really want to keep that also in mind. Even though Eugene over the years was limited because of the physical challenges that he had, one thing that I observed of him is that in spite that he was not able to move and do things that he would have wanted, he gave his support. He gave his support. in whatever little way. And if it meant that he had to drive his car and come around and just sit and talk the way that we know that he talked from time to time, he would do that. And I think the membership would have lost a true soldier, a dedicated husband, and a dedicated servant of the Lord. There's much more that I could say, but nevertheless, we want to remember Eugene for the support that he would have given to his family, to people in general, given his limitations that he would have encountered during his lifetime. We know that to be absent from the body is present with the Lord, and we know that he is in a better place. He has left us here to fight all these perils, all these dangers that we're exposed to. So he's lulling off in heaven. And I believe he might be sitting maybe close to Sister Nelson. God bless you.
Thank you so much, Pastor Nelson. You know, sometimes we find out more about people when they die more than they are alive, yeah? I just learned some truth about Brother Eugene there. And we can take a page out of his book by trying to be supportive, yes? That's one part of his legacy. To God be the glory. At this time, we have another tribute in song, and Brother Lovell is going to come to bring that tribute for us. Stand together for Brother Lovell. Sing lustily and gloriously unto the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Blessing. Good afternoon to everyone.
This is mine. God will show.
We are going to have the eulogy done by Brother Wade. Yes, we heard a lot about Brother Eugene before, so now we're going to sit back and listen to a more lengthy rendition of some things about our brother Eugene Cruz.
To celebrate the life of Eugene Ishmael Bruce, known to most of you all as Smooth, was born on the 10th of January 1966. He was the son of Matilda Bruce, deceased, and Thomas Bear of the U.S. Husband of Hilda Frank Bruce, father of little drummer boy Theo Bruce. Brother of Harry deceased, Brian, Dexter, myself, and Karen. Uncle of Casey, Andrea, Laura, Kelsey, Samantha, Karim, Denzel, Bevon, and many others. Great uncle of Benny, brother-in-law of Pixie, Humphrey, and Eric of the USA. Friend of Damian Sobers, Cephas, Dominic Abraham, Sister Esther Loveless, Samantha Mills, Bernada Frank, Charlene, Sister Elsa Wells, and members of the Abundant Life Ministry, special friend of Anita Kennedy. Eugene was the fifth of six children, always jolly and had a passion for music to the extent where he will sit on his step in those days with his afro and the booming song from his music system transforming the atmosphere. In those days he was fondly called Dr. Hyde with his matching physical structure. He loved people dearly and always willing to go the extra mile. He attended Patience Hill Catholic School, as it was called in those days. Then he went on to Scarborough Secondary, where one of his closest friends was Junior Innes, who unfortunately cannot make it. Upon completion of his schooling, he started chucking with his cousin Allison until he gained full employment with the Trinidad and Tobago Electricity Company, a job which he held until he was diagnosed with a serious medical condition. Brothers and sisters, he is presently in the hand of the Lord, so there is no more pain, no more pain. May his soul rest in eternal peace.
May his soul rest in peace, and we know that with certainty because our brother Eugene has gone on to heaven. Yes, we're not guessing that, we know that. Yes. To be absent from the body, what we say is to be present with the Lord. Yes. At this time, we're going to take up some offering, and the ushers are going to come and bring the baskets to you so you don't have to get up. I'm going to call the worship team, please surrender us a song as we take up the offerings. Thank you.
To God be the glory. Amen. Marching on in the light of God, marching on, I am marching on. All the power, my master's God, marching, marching on. A robe by the cross, a man of
this morning, this is indeed a celebration. And knowing our dear brother, he would not have had it any other way. This afternoon, as I share with you, I want to focus your attention on Luke chapter 12, and I'm going to read from verse 16. Luke chapter 12. From verse 16. And he, Jesus, spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plenty. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that laid up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. These are the words of Scripture, and it is blessed in your hearing. And for the next 15 minutes or so, as I engage your attention here this afternoon, let me say that the time in which we now live demand that every man and every woman take time to reflect, take time to give serious thought and consideration regarding their lives. And if I were to put a title to what I share with you today, I would simply title it Reflection. Jesus speaking in this parable, he said concerning this man that I read about, he said that this man had a successful agricultural business. Not only was his business business was successful, according to what the text said. He had a business model that was very enterprising. Due to the success of his fields that produced much fruit, he said, "What shall I do? I have barns, but they cannot contain the magnitude of what has been reaped." And in enterprise and thinking, he said, "This I will do. I will build bigger barns." Jesus also implied in the text that this man was wealthy. If you are successful to the degree that he was in business, and if you are as enterprising as he was, indeed you will gain financial wealth. Jesus, the text said that he was rich. But according to God, even though we saw all these things positive about this man, God said that he was a fool. Yeah. Hear me this afternoon, brothers and sisters. God said that he was stupid. This is the meaning of the word. God said that he was without reason and reflection. God said that he was without good sense and judgment. Now the question is here this afternoon. Why would God call such a man a fool? And the reason why God described, and the reason why God concluded that this man was a fool, is because after he deliberated, after he thought within himself, the decision that followed his reflection is the reason why God described him as such. You see, brethren, the decision of this man pursuant to the success of his fruitful labor, pursuant to having amassed the material and financial security needed for comfortable retirement, the decision that he made were filled with items of self gratification, absent of those things meaningful for the soul. This is what he decided. With the success that I have come into, I am going to eat, I am going to drink, and I am going to be married. It is for this God said to him, thou fool. Let me, as I hasten on, submit to you here this afternoon. The time has come. It is not coming. The time has come for us all to consider serious reflection, to consider serious thoughts concerning our lives. And as we give serious thought to our lives in these times in which we live, indeed, I submit to you that our reflection must take into consideration, number one, the requirement of your soul. You see, one of the things that we can be assured of, every one of us, is that your soul and my soul will be required by God. And our souls will be required by God because it is He, it is God who is in control of our souls that are to be required. And let me say this as we glean from the text. Amen. Riches are not in control of the requirement of our souls. Status and position in this life that men, amen, compete for, and that men, amen, do all kinds of things to assume. Listen to me. These things are not in control of the requirement of your soul. God is in control of the requirement of the soul that He gave to all men, and He will always be in control. And what we learn from these words of Jesus is that the requirement of our souls can be sudden. It can be unexpected. It can find us unprepared. This is what happened to this wealthy man. God said to him after he had said, God said to him, this night, oh Spirit of the living God, he did not have a moment longer. God said, tonight. Oh apostle, listen to me, amen. We are not the vanguards of our own lives, and we need, amen, now to reflect, consider the fact, amen, that things all around us is happening unexpected, it's happening suddenly, and many people are unprepared. But my submission is, get prepared, because, amen, God can call any time, any day, moment. And please note with me, earthly riches does not help us when our souls are required. Now I'm not discouraging you, amen, to better the standard and quality of your life. But as you do so, please understand, when your soul is required, it is not how much, amen, I have in the bank. It is not about how well I dress or the kind of car I drive. When my soul is required, even if I drive a chalupa, amen, if I am ready, oh Spirit of God. You see, we cannot carry none of these earthly resources with us when the soul is required. And our earthly achievements, the amalgamation of our earthly gettings, important as they are for this world, they are not the currency for admission into God's heaven. Our reflection must consider the requirement of our souls. But then, of course, as I bring this short thought to close, please note also that our reflection must consider our relation to God. Verse 21, Jesus speaking, he said, "This is the life, the end result, the outcome of such a man who is not rich towards God." I encourage us all, let us get rich towards God. And you may say to me, "How can I do that?" Listen to me. You get rich to God if you have not received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Start today. Are you with me? If you are serving Jesus, you know him as Lord and Savior, don't stop now and don't stop ever. Get rich towards God. If there has been a slowdown in your walk with God, listen to me. Slack not your riding. Pick the pace back up. Oh, hallelujah. We get rich towards God by placing our trusts, our faith in him, by obeying what he said. You know what Solomon said after he observed all the vanity, amen, under the sun? He said, this is the conclusion, that men should fear God and what? Keep his commandments. This is how we get rich toward God. There is no question, the life that we are here to celebrate was indeed rich toward God. And I have appreciated all the things said about him here on this platform. You know why? They were true. Many a times he would say to me, "Pastor, One of these days you're going to see me walking back into that church, you know. Used to always say to me, Pastor, if I was on my legs, the amount of things we would have done to finish this building. I said, don't worry, man. Amen. You're doing, amen, what God would have you to do. And even though, as the bishop said, amen, glory to God, he could not, amen, bring a bucket of cement. He would park his car there and keep our company. When we needed a plumber, he sourced the plumber. He said, Pastor, don't worry. Amen. I'm going to take care of that. Amen. Was his life rich towards God? Beyond the shadow of a doubt, he was rich towards God. But the question is, your lives is my life. Because when I preach, I don't preach down. Are you with me? I preach for myself also to hear. We need to be rich towards God. And so, reflection on these considerations necessitates that we come to a decision. This is what the rich man did, yes? When you read from verses 16 to 18, when you read verses 19 as well, after he sought within himself, he made a decision. And the decision, of course, as he made, that he made, was not in keeping with God's liking, but that does not have to be the same for us. Reflection, brothers and sisters. We need to reflect on the requirement of our souls, as I described, and our relation to God. Here's what the prophet Joel said in Joel chapter 3 and verse 14. Multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. What is going to be your decision today? Let me invite you to please stand. Unto your people, speak to our souls even now. Yes, Father, even as we would leave from this place, let the voice of this word continue to echo in our hearing. Reflection. And so now I commit them into your care and into your control. In Jesus' mighty name. You know what? Is there anybody here who is saying, I'm ready to make a decision? You don't have to come up. Just lift your hands. I'm going to see it. Is there anybody here who is saying, decision? I see that hand. The Lord bless you. Is there another? Amen. Thank you, my dear sister. God bless you. I now hand over the mic to our church.
Recognize some students among us. They are Theo's classmates, and Theo is the son of our dearly departed brother Eugene. Can you please stand up so that we could see you well? And also the teacher, Kim Ewing. Thank you for coming. Good to have you, please. Thank you. And just want to say thank you to everybody who came. We're not finished yet, but just saying thank you before you leave. And we appreciate it that you came to celebrate this life with us this evening. I'm now going to call Pastor Nelson to do a special prayer. He's going to pray for the family of the bereaved. Pastor Nelson. For the family members, please stand up. We will be sitting together.
We still want to observe the protocols, so we don't want to cluster. We want to just really be as cooperative as possible. So I'm going to ask you to come. I will just ask you to remain right where you are. Let us pray. Our God and our Father, this evening, we thank you. For indeed you are the God of all peace. You are the God of all grace. And when we think about your grace, we think about that which you gave freely, so that our lives can experience the benefits, the good. Physical man, to the mental man, the mental part of us, our social life, our emotions, our spiritual lives. So with this in mind, even as this family will go through this season of loss and grief and a sense at times of being void of an absent family member, we thank you because you are able to step in, and you are more than able to give them that which is required so that they can make it safely through this journey. So we ask now that you're going to strengthen them. We ask, dear God, you're going to give them the peace that passes all understanding. We ask, Lord God, that even in the days and the months and the years ahead, as you will give them life, we ask, oh God, that somehow they're going to fulfill your purpose. And we pray, dear God, for whatever decisions that needs to be made from a family point of view. The many things that need to be done, and the grace and the help that they will require. We ask even now, oh God, that you would begin to make those crooked paths straight. Those rough places will be made smooth, and those mountains will become level grounds, because you are the God of all grace, the God of all might, that is able to do all things. We pray for continual peace amongst them. We know, dear God, that a in situation in times like these, the possibilities always exist to have rift, arguments, divisions, separations. But we pray, O God, that you are going to overshadow every life, and that even the departure of our brother will be a means, O God, where their lives will be impacted upon in a positive way, more than the negative. Bring them together. Let there be a closer relationship. Bind them together with cords that cannot be broken. And we will not forget that the enemy, the devil, is always lurking, seeking for an opportunity to make inroads, but deceiving, oh God. We understand the power that you have given unto us. We rebuke the plans and the works of the enemy, where he will seek, oh God, to inflict them with unnecessary pains. Satan, we stop you in your tracks now. We say, get thee hence. You are not welcome amongst the family of the Bruce. You are not welcome amongst them. We drive out your works. We command all your cunning craftiness to come to naught in the mighty name of Jesus. We cover them under your blood. And as your will is being done in heaven, let your will be done in their lives individually, collectively, as a family. Touch Sister Hilda in a very special way. Touch to you, oh God. Bless them and keep them. Thank you for the victory in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for that individual who would have lifted her hands. We take not her lifting of that hand lightly. We pray that conversion right now will begin. Let her experience the impartation of a new life in Jesus. Cause her to experience the joy and the peace of sins forgiven, iniquities pardoned, oh God. Bring new life. Raise her up. Raise her up, God. Transfer her. Bring her out from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of your dear Son, Jesus Christ. Bless everyone that came, every home that is represented here this evening. Let peace reign. Continue to cover us under your blood. We commit, O God, our twin island at this time into your hands. And even as we go through this season, O God of fear for some, protect us, bring healing and deliverance. Cause us, O God, as a people, to experience the might of your healing, your salvation, goodness and mercy will follow us all the days of our lives. And may be pleased that we all will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and forever. We thank you for hearing us in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Pastor Nelson. At this time, we are going to have the viewing of the body. Pastor is going to come back to the podium. So we're not going to have any repast. Is that correct? Say yes. But you can have some refreshments after we leave this building. There'll be a vehicle parked outside, and each person is to take something and move away very quickly. We are trying not to encourage any congregating, yes? Thank you very much, Pastor.
Okay, so let me say thanks to all of you for coming here today. We are now going to have the recessional of the body, followed by heading to Buccoo for the final repose of the remains of our brother. Amen?
Amen?
So the Lord bless you all and take care of yourselves. In Jesus' name, amen? Blessings.
Praise the Lord. So
you could take the body down where it started, and the final viewing will be done there. Thank you. As we sing our final hymn, what a friend we have in Jesus. Okay, and because of social distancing, we will ask you all to start from the back, view and depart. No gathering, please.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs again. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit, oh, what needless days we get.
Yazan.
You didn't have a little touch with anyone?
Yeah, a little thing now.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
Oh, What do you think about Jesus? He's alright. What do you think about Jesus? I know my. What do you think about Jesus? He's alright. What do you think about Jesus? I know my. Don't try to tell me my Lord is dead. Woke me up this morning. Don't try to tell me he's not alive. I told him today. He opened up my mind to life and set my spirit free.
Who has the final say?